But I'm saying right now because it changes day to day. And we'll just see. Okay, so today I want to finish up the psychoacoustics topic, psychoacoustics and signal processing. I'm going to just show you some little example of, after a little bit of talk here about masking, a little bit examples of signal processing using psychoacoustic units. The stuff I'm showing you today is not earth-shattering. It's something that a student and I worked on years ago. And it's not amazingly great. It's not bad either. It's just sort of typical stuff that people do, just for you to get a feel of what you might do. But I would not call it, you know, a landmark exercise or thing. I just want to show you sort of what we did because we were interested in a problem and where it got us. After that, we're going to start the rest of the semester, which besides being on Echo 360 after the after I'm done lecturing to an empty room here, we'll also each lecture will be about a different synthesis technique. And next lecture is going to be the first one after break is going to be about fixed waveform synthesis. So basically, you're making the same repeating exact waveform. You know some about that because you've seen the phase oscillator. Some of you asked for regrades on the phase oscillator and still really don't have much of an idea of what frequency accuracy is there. If you could ask me or if you could come to office hours or something, that would be great because I'd love for you to actually understand it better. The regrade requests are always a little disappointing when they argue the exact same thing the original thing said, and it's as wrong as it was the first time. So I would love to straighten it out, and you might not get any points for it, but if you've got the time and the interest, please don't hesitate. Okay, so we're going to do the psychoacoustic stuff, and then we're going to start the last part of the lecture. I'm going to start on next lecture's topic, and that's just because next lecture's topic got too long. I like to show sound examples and stuff, and last semester I ran out of time. So this semester I sort of moved it up, and I'm just going to give a start on that topic. Okay, so psychoacoustics and signal processing. Again, this is another thing that you could do a graduate, you know, a master's or PhD on, or maybe even have a whole department that specializes in this. So we're just kind of flying through this, doing some hand-waving introductory things. For instance, for your hearing system, you know, I showed you an ear model and stuff, and we talked some about very vague terms, you know, what does a cochlea do, and about the place principle. Those are all important things to know, but there's a lot more. And there's a lot of new research like, well, what happens, what happens in the nervous system after all those hair cells pick up the signal? And it's very interesting because your hearing system is not the same as your vision system, but it does seem to sort of make a 2D representation out of this 1D signal and then process that somewhat in similar ways that you process optical information. So it's kind of a bizarre thing. I mean, signal processing usually, well, 1D is way easier to deal with than 2D. But in biological systems, things are different. So there's a lot of research there, a lot of interest there. Some explanation you'll see later here that, like, well, you have this nice harmonic sound, so things are equally spaced in your FFT. And actually, it really helps to find your peaks in your FFT that correspond to some fundamental. Well, it turns out that on your cochlea, that's not true. On your cochlea, harmonic sounds, they get all weirdly spaced. It's like, why would you do that? That just makes it hard to analyze. Well, I think part of the answer lies in, because your ears clearly pick out what harmonics belong together, and, you know, this is all one sound, and you do that very easily all the time. So, and you can hear very non-harmonic sounds, a single sound, just as easily as harmonic sounds. And, you know, why does a mechanism work that way when most things you'd listen to are harmonic? Well, some of that answer is, you know, what happens in the nervous system later. But just like the optical nerve, even before it gets to your brain, is very complicated, the same thing happens in your hearing system. There's a lot of stuff going on there. And we won't really talk about that much, but I will show you some examples of things that are sort of surprising. I mean, the thing to get in your head is, look, the ear is not just an FFT. Okay. So The ear does have a few things. It's got this masking thing. And what's masking? Well, it's when one frequency is really close to another frequency on the cochlea, you know, you can't have two places on the cochlea that are vibrating really strong and they're infinitely close together. It doesn't work, you know, because there's viscosity in the fluid, right? If there's vibration right here and vibration right here, well, they're going to merge at some point. Also, if there's vibration right here, it's not going to be totally still, you know, a tenth of a millimeter away. Similarly, the basal membrane is also moving, you know, it's got, so there's viscosity and properties of the membrane and stuff. So you're going to have any frequency sort of spreads out. And as an engineer, you say, oh, great, that's just like the window function makes things spread out in an FFT. Maybe a little. I would say just like is too much to say. This is, you know, wet and goopy. Your FFT isn't. Okay, so we'll talk about this some, though. What are the effects of this first, and then we'll look at how you might do something in signal processing. If you have two distinctly different frequencies, like it says on the upper left, you learn before your midterm that, yeah, you can add up Sohn's units. And it really works. And Sohn's units are really cool because, like, if you want to ask somebody, well, does this pure tone sound twice as loud as that one, it'll work. And there's lots of other, you know, lots of things you can do with Sohn's units. They're really cool. But it's only for distinctly different frequencies. Well, and what that distinctly different means, it's sort of a vague term, but what it means is that you're far enough apart in the cochlea that they don't interact too much. Right, that place principle where you have different frequencies affecting, you know, being picked up along different parts of the cochlea, of the basilar membrane, you know, if they're far enough apart, then they don't interact much. In this graph here, you've got two tones. This is one tone here is stable. F1, the labels, the axes aren't even labeled. This is sort of a generic thing that happens. And if you're ever in the lab alone and nobody else to torture there, don't use headphones for this. Never use headphones when you're experimenting around it, or earbuds. But, you know, and you find, and you have some reasonably good speakers. Then you can try this. You have one sine wave, keep it, you know, just as some frequency and sweep another one slowly, and you'll hear all these effects. So when they're significantly different frequencies there, or far enough apart, then you get two different, you just hear the two different sine waves, and it's smooth. So we were talking about, like, one of the exam questions was about, well, do you hear, you know, on a Hammond organ, when you play Hammond organ, right, you play lots of notes, it's only got 91 tone wheels. So, right, the reason you don't hear the roughness is because all the harmonics are rounded off to the nearest equal tempered scale step. Or in a mechanical sense, all the harmonics share, you know, if they're close to each other, they just share the same tone wheel. And if they don't share that one, they use the next one. So there's no, you know, things are either far apart or they're exactly the same. And in either case, in the center here, you have a smooth sensation. And on the edges here, you have a smooth sensation. So either way, everything is pretty smooth, and you can't really get dissonance out of a Hammond organ the same way you would out of other instruments. Something that really makes it unique and really makes it interesting, actually. So here you got smooth, way out here because they're so different. If they are really close together, well, if they're the same frequency, like on the Hammond organ, well, you get smooth too, right? Because they're the same frequency. So you're good. But what happens in between here? There's an area called the critical band, which again has definitions, but we're not going to get into the deep definition of it and how it's measured exactly because there's actually variations there. But the critical band, for our purposes, is just the range in which these things interact, the frequency range in which the two sine waves interact with each other. Now, when you're at the edge of the critical band, this is where you get your dissonance. At first you hear two different tones still, but they sound rough. And that's super important in music, right? Because you want to have chords that resolve to something that's much smoother. I mean, it's super important for building up tension for everything else. One of the reasons why the Hammond organ, I keep coming back to that, but it's really fundamentally a different instrument. And when people try to play their favorite piano concerto on it, and say, ew, that sounds gross. Well, I'm sorry, but you're an idiot. You know, it's not the thing you play a piano concerto on. I mean, it just makes no sense. You know, do what you can do with it that's cool. I'm one of those people that really disliked Hammond organ for a long time until I studied more. And I have to admit, it got into my heart by way of, you know, how do you get to a nerd's heart? Well, through his brain, right? And then I listened more for things, and I really appreciate it. But here you go. Here's the... what am I saying here? Here's these two different frequencies you hear, and it sounds rough. Now, these two tones, in this example, are the same amplitude. So, and again, this is sort of a simplified graph, right? This clearly isn't data. This is showing things. Then you get this thing where the tones fuse, where they're close enough together that, you know, it looks like one bump of activity, basically, to your nervous system. It doesn't look like two separate things. It can't be resolved anymore. So now you're hearing one average frequency, but it sounds rough. And as you get down here, the average frequency, you still hear the average frequencies, but it sounds nice. That's sort of that chorus effect. You can look down here if you want at the beat frequencies. You know, the rate of beating is just the difference between the two. And it's a pleasant sound. If they're really close, it's pleasant. Also, if they're really far apart, it's pleasant. If they are in between, I would say it is, unpleasant might be the wrong word, but it sounds rough. And so that's what's going on there. And it sort of makes sense in the if you think physically about, you know, the simplified understanding we have of the cochlea and the basilar membrane, right? Makes sense that you would have these kinds of effects. But if you want stringent intervals, you need that kind of roughness. Okay, so an important thing here is if you want to do Sohn's units, all of that math and stuff works for distinctly different frequencies. And does that mean that, well, I mean, if you're playing, you know, music recording, you're always going to have close frequencies. So there, maybe those units are of less obvious use. But if you look at lots of engineering problems, like you just have motor whine or something, and you have you can adjust things so you have whine at these harmonics or at that harmonic or whatever. You know, you can actually use it to do all sorts of useful calculations. All right, questions about this? Yes.
Now, this all the bands and everything are really rough. Can you give like an estimate of where a half step would be in this? Perhaps.
It's complicated. I know this is sort of wimping out. I'm also not an expert in the area, right? If I really were an expert in this, I'd probably be able to give you some practical examples. But one thing to point out is you're looking at all the different harmonics here. And every harmonic has this kind of graph, right? So if you're a half step apart, on the one, you know, the 20th harmonic might be in a roughness range with the 21st harmonic of the other, or whatever it is. And so some of the harmonics will not interact with each other very much, or they'll, you know. But anyway, what happens in a half-step interval is that you have a lot more of them that are in this roughness range. And so it's not just, you know, for a single sine wave, when you listen to it, it sounds like a, you know, a bad physics experiment. I mean, it's really not very enjoyable. I used to do this in front of the class, and people just said, you know, just skip that one. So I'm skipping it. Especially because in a big room, you have to play aloud so the people in the front really suffer. And of course, I'm standing behind the speaker, so I don't get it. But in any case, the answer, I think my worst out answer would be, if you just counted up the pairs of harmonics that are closest to each other, you're going to have a lot more of them that are rough. Now, some of them are going to be in the sweet range. You know, and some of them are going to be far apart, and that's fine, but many of them will be in the roughness range. And depending on how you tune your half step, like if you use a just tempered half step, you'll have many, you'll have a way smaller number that are in the rough range. So the half step that we're used to playing that's perfectly equal to tempered on a piano, I mean on a MIDI keyboard, is especially nasty. On the other hand, we've gotten used to that. And it is sort of interesting when you hear older music played with older tunings, you know, it actually wasn't quite as raucous as it sounds now. You know, when you listen to a lot of things, I don't know, from Bach or something. You got to keep in mind, man, like his organ music was wild. You know, it was, you know, you had this big instrument and he was going to shake the house. So that's great. But a lot of the other music, though, you hear, it's actually a lot finer and a lot prettier and a lot less hit you over the head if you play it with original tunings. So that was kind of a long, dribbly answer, but I don't have a real good, you know, real good numbers, except you would count number of harmonics. Like, looking at one harmonic is nice, but if you just count number of harmonics that are in the nastiness range, in the rough range, that gives you a pretty good idea. And exactly how big that is, that you will see. Because on this critical band, it's related to one bark. And you'll see what bark units are on the next page. Bark units, or page after next. So bark units are, you know, sort of tell you. So if you are very close, you know, if you're 0.1 barks apart in frequency, it's going to sound nice. If you're like 0.7, 0.8, you're definitely going to hear roughness. I'm not super expert. I played around with it some, but this is for each harmonic individually, and then you've got all these other weird things, like your hearing is more sensitive in certain ranges than others, and so it gets real complicated. Thanks. All right. So here is a masking pattern. See if I can make that fit. Yeah, it kind of fits. Okay, so masking pattern, noise, band, and sign. So if you have a noise band here, which is at 415 hertz, okay, this graph is not that complicated, but it's really important to understand the graph. This ML just is dB units, is ML stands for masking level. But basically, it's decibels on that axis. This axis is frequency, but it's not linear. You can see, right, it's like in octaves. It's log frequency the way it's labeled. This is octaves or log frequency, that is masking level in dB. So it's sort of a log-log thing. Now, when it says 20 here, this is how loud is this noise band at 415 hertz? 30 is how loud is it? So this graph here has to do with when it's 20, when it's 30, when it's 40, 50, 60, 70, or 80 dB intensity level. So 80 dB is the intensity level, or the masking level, of the noise band. Okay, no, I'm sorry, that's intensity level of the noise band. The masking level is what we're talking about here, is these other funny curves. So let's say you had a noise band at 450 hertz, a narrowband noise, 415 hertz, and it's at 80 dB. So that's pretty loud. It's well below pain. It's not, you know, it's not terribly loud, but it's loud enough. So you're at 80 dB, the question is, if you have this noise band at 80 dB, this outer graph here is showing you at all the frequencies, how loud would another sinusoid have to be, another component have to be, so you could hear it. If it's below this line, so it's sort of a threshold of hearing in the presence of this 80 dB noise. Does that make any sense? So, what this is saying is that if you're playing if you have this noise band at 415 hertz, and you want to play, say, a 1,000 hertz sinusoid, or a 1,000 hertz partial, you will not even hear its existence at all until you get above 40-some dB there, intensity level. Okay? Just masked out. And you know this happens, right? If it's noisy in the room, it's hard to hear somebody talk. You're sort of familiar with this. But this is psychoacousticians really studying it. So it's interesting, if you look at this 80 dB graph, let's look at the outermost one. First thing is, at low frequencies, like, the masking is much less than at high frequencies. Because remember, this is already log frequency axis. And still, the right side is much longer. So you can go up to 1,000 hertz, which is over twice the 415 hertz, and you still have loads of masking going on. Well, if you go to half, the masking is very little. right? So that's one thing to know, is that frequency, you know, higher frequencies get masked a lot more than lower frequencies. So in the presence of something, of a sinusoid or noise band in this case, higher frequencies get masked a lot more than lower frequencies. Super important to know. When it says pure tone here again, that just means partial or sine wave. Yes, so slope of frequencies above the masker varies from, you get much more masking above a frequency. Secondly, there's a bump at twice of 450 hertz there. So you get more masking there at twice the frequency. Why is that? Well, there's an explanation down here. The middle ear impedance matcher, you know, the hammer, anvil, and stirrup. I put impedance matcher in quotes, but it's, I'm talking engineer talk with a little bit tongue-in-cheek, but yeah, you know, that's sort of what it is causing harmonic distortion. So if you play out loud enough pure tone or even noise band or anything in here, you get harmonic distortion because of your ear. Doesn't matter how good your earbuds are. Right? Your ear, you just will never perceive a very loud, pure sinusoid because your ear makes harmonic distortion. Just the way it goes. So that's why there's a bump there. Because there's harmonic distortion, so there's yet extra masking an octave above. Due to the harmonic distortion. So really, your noise band is here, but your ear sort of also makes a band of noise here because of the harmonic distortion. Now, the harmonic distortion is much more at high amplitudes than at low amplitudes. So, you know, your middle ear is nonlinear and it's got some problems, but the problems are much less at lower amplitudes. So these graphs actually look different at all different amplitudes. Right? If your masker is, say, 50, well, it's hard to see, but you're going to get much less distortion. In any case, for that reason and for other reasons, right, it's nonlinear. With frequency, the whole mechanism isn't a linear system. It's a biological system. So when you look at the different noise bands, not only like are they different on the left and on the right, so they're not symmetrical, but also each one of them is different than the other. And that is icky. You know, how do you do anything with this data? Because not only have that, but if you say instead of using a 415 hertz, you used, I don't know, a 700 hertz noise band, you get yet different graphs. And they'd all be different than any of these. Right? So you got lots of stuff. So if you want to do signal processing, you got to figure out some way to make these graphs look nicer, to at least do some sort of approximation, some sort of change of units. Is the approach often taken, so that these graphs would look more uniform. If you use the right units, it's not a perfect approximation, but if it's close enough, that's good. I mean, and if close enough is a complicated thing to measure, but keep in mind, too, that humans all vary from each other some anyway. So, you know, it's believable that there's something that might be close enough and not perfectly match this, but do better. All right, are we good? All right. So now I'm going to give you, because that was a noise and sine wave, and that's kind of weird. A lot of times psychoacousticians like using pure tones, like using sine waves or just pure partials. But then we have this noise band, and they do that too. Narrowband noise is a thing. But here is a graph that you don't need to memorize everything about, but just instead of having a noise band here, in this case it's at 1200 hertz, it's not 450, it's just some other data I found. But it's one pure tone, so one sinusoid masking another. And there's all these different regions, there's all this different stuff, there's still harmonic distortion, but it is really complicated. And again, this is just for one amplitude, this is just a graph for one amplitude of masker. So one particular amplitude at 1200 hertz gives you all those regions, but a different amplitude at 1200 hertz would give you other things. So it's a pretty pretty messy thing. And you can kind of see ranges here that vaguely relate to that other graph we saw, but everything is complicated, right? You can see that you hear you know, a primary, secondary, and different tone. Sometimes you only hear one, you know, the different tone. So you hear all these different things in these different regions. So nothing is simple here. Yes?
So when they made these graphs, was it just sort of the same kind of experiment like with the Fletcher-Munson curves where they just asked a bunch of people, hey, what does this sound like?
Yeah. It's a real art to do good audio things. Like, I don't know how it is now because I don't read all the bulletin boards, but when I was a student, the speech and hearing department was always recruiting for audio testing. And you could get $20 or something by going there. And one of the things that said right on the poster was, please don't eat any milk products or drink any milk for breakfast. Because it turns out that milk products really affect your hearing more than many other things you might eat. If you ever eat too much, like at your Easter meal or something, just sit back and listen. You know, it's kind of funny. Like, you don't notice because you've always had this. But after you've eaten too much, your hearing is really messed up. In any case, for those tests, right, you have silly things like that. Like, what did people eat? What are people using? You know, and then, of course, all the variations among individuals, like, because some individuals have hearing loss due to a medical thing or due to having listened to loud rock and roll or whatever it is. Or due to having been in the military or whatever it is. You know, there's lots of ways so it's really hard to do good tests. But if you want to do this yourself, you don't make a publishable test. But what you can do is just see that it happens. It's just not particularly fun. I mean, if you're really interested, it's okay, but make sure nobody else is in the room. So there's all this stuff. So, you know, again, you got this harmonic distortion because of the middle ear, but the middle ear is nonlinear. I mean, harmonic distortion is sort of one measure of nonlinearity. There's a lot of different things that are going on here in fluid dynamics and how the internal systems work. Even long before all this information gets into your nervous system, there's all sorts of stuff going on. So the real challenge is for music DSP. I mean, I'm looking at this and I'm just sort of talking about it. You don't need to worry about it too much except, it's really complicated. So the challenge is, how can you use any of this information practically? And I'm going to show you one example. As I say, this isn't an earth-shattering cornerstone piece of work in history. It's just sort of something we did. So I will show you that on the next page. There's one more topic I want to talk about because this is another thing that's disconcerting to engineers, is temporal masking. Okay, so what we have here is, as it says here, the hatched bar shows temporal and spectral extent of master. So here's this hatched bar on there. So at time zero, you've got some noise band starting up, and at time 500 milliseconds, it stops. And it's one bark wide. It's going to be 21, 22 barks. I'm sorry, barks are a frequency unit. We'll talk about them next page. So it's one bark wide. So this is a frequency axis here in barks this time, not log frequency. Although in this range, it's related to log frequency. Then there's loudness in the vertical axis. So what happens here? Well, after this noise thing, which is louder, the vertical axis of the noise isn't shown. It just shows in frequency and in time how long does it last. It stops after 500 milliseconds, and even 30 milliseconds, even as long as 100 milliseconds later, not shown here, but you get significant masking because of this noise that stopped half a second ago, which is kind of surprising. But especially on the tail end, it's one of the reasons why Eigen matrix formulas have this persistence idea in them, right? Is that in your hearing system, your recovery from something having gone on is rather slow, much slower than the onset processing. So due to various effects, your ear, if nothing else, your ear has active components in it trying to amplify things. And it takes them a while to figure out, oh, wait, this ain't happening anymore. So there's sort of that active hair cell issue. There's also other things just about, well, if there's vibrations, they're not going to suddenly stop. They're going to keep going for a while, even if there weren't an active amplification system. There's all sorts of issues there. So that's called forward masking. That, that means that in future things you might not hear due to that. A weirder one for engineers is this backmasking thing. So if that noise band starts, there's actually things that happened before it that you can't hear anymore. So, you know, the first response is, oh, well, you know, it's a non-causal system, right? It's telling the it's telling the future, and that's not the that's not the case. I mean, yeah, it looks non-causal, and your FFT doesn't do this, but all that's going on here is that loud sounds make it through hearing faster than quiet, right? It makes sense that that would happen, like something for your survival. I suspect something loud that suddenly happens. You better pay attention to. I mean, the quiet slithering snake, you gotta care about too. But at least it's slithering quietly. It's not, but the loud sound, you want to react too fast. So that's just another complexity of the hearing system, making it very different from your favorite FFT. Is that loud sounds get through it faster than quiet ones do, and it's significantly faster. I mean, you've got a good 20, 30 milliseconds here of significant amount of masking. So that's temporal masking. Now, when does this matter? Oh, this matters a lot for, especially for audio music encoding. Like if you're trying to encode, audio compression, and the violist comes in, 15 milliseconds before the whole orchestra has its big hit, and everybody plays. Nobody's gonna hear that. Viola's safe. No, but also if you are going to if you're going to compress it, right? The whole idea of audio compression is that you want to keep the information that people can actually hear and get rid of stuff that you can't hear. So it's super, super, super important that this happens. And anything with a drum beat in it and such, it makes it much, much, much easier because those onsets, you don't need every last detail of the onsets or what happened quietly just before the drum beat because you can't hear it anyway. Does that make sense? So this is really important. Now, in electronic music, probably less so. This isn't an audio class, it's an electronic music class, but it's something to think about. There's also other effects, like just long-term effects, fatigue effects, and eventually actually hearing damage effects. And there's weird ones, like from sounds that aren't very loud. If they persist, if day after day after day you hear the same fan, even if it's not anywhere near hearing damage, you could get hearing damage after, years of doing that. So that's a different issue. That's not forward back masking. That's longer, and fatigue effects are a longer term thing. All right, are we good? Yes?
What does forward masking mean?
So there's forward masking and back masking. So at time t equals zero, this thing starts, okay? Back masking means stuff before it even started, you can't hear. So that's a weird one, is back masking. Forward masking just means after it's over, it takes you a while to recover until you can start hearing quiet things again. Oh, okay. So the forward masking, is forward in time, it's not that weird. Back masking or back in time masking is the weird one because basically, if you're at time t equals minus 15 here and some sound happens, you're not going to hear it because some future event will happen. Which, to an engineer seems weird, but right, it's not, it's because of this, you're talking about long delays getting through your hearing system anyway. These are also important times because, people sit around and discuss how important it is that MIDI is accurate, needs to be accurate to 8 microseconds or something. And it's like, well, take it all with a grain of salt. But don't underestimate your hearing system. There's a lot of bizarre things that your hearing system can do. For instance, we talked about this before, where you have things like proven that at low frequencies, you can't determine the frequency of a sine wave very accurately at all. Like, even a half step accuracy or something, it's just terrible accuracy. On the other hand, if you actually play a low note on a real instrument, on an acoustic instrument or even electronic instrument, you have very good frequency accuracy, and that's because of all the harmonics, right? So things are often more complicated than they seem. So even though this makes it look like, well, your timing accuracy can't be that great, be careful about that. Because you could still be able to tell simultaneities and stuff very accurately, maybe not exactly in absolute time when they happen, but were they simultaneous or not? And so there's various things that you can do. Right, because this doesn't show you the variation in speed through the right ear and left ear for a particular thing. And so as long as the variation between the two isn't very much, you can still tell sample tonalities and other things very accurately. Are we good? Yes.
When it says a non-causal system, is that a no below it?
Yeah, that's just no. Yeah, I mean non-causalist makes sense, right? It doesn't predict the future. Are you an ECE major?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So what I mean to say by this is just, does it predict the future? Does it have ESP? And no. Just it's a weird thing when you have a recording and you're looking at some part of it that nobody's going to hear because something that happens later in the recording. You know, that actually makes sense. Yes?
Do you maybe think of it like your hearing system is sort of bracing itself? Would that sort of make more sense? Like it's always...
Yeah, and...
ready?
Well, okay, there may be some of that too, yeah. But also it's just, you know, that's actually a good thing because you don't want damage. And there's actually, because it's an active system and there's a lot of active, you have a large range of sounds that aren't painful, and the quieter ones are just amplified more by the system than the loud ones. So yeah, there may be some of that, and there may just be some of the survival thing. You know, something loud might be more important. I mean, keep in mind that for instance, for survival, your hearing is much more important than your seeing, which always surprises people. But you know, people that go blind do much better than people that go deaf. And there's a whole variety of reasons for that. I mean, one is a social. You can still talk to people. That's a big deal. But the other thing is, like when you're crossing a street, yeah, you know, your seeing tells you all sorts of things. But in the end, hearing that truck coming, or even hearing the horn on the truck, if you can see and you aren't looking that way, well, it doesn't do you any good. So it turns out that, yeah, when you ever get asked the question, well, would you rather go blind or deaf? You'll actually be happy or blind, even though there's lots of other problems with that. So your hearing system is really important for survival, and so some of these optimizations may be part of that. All right, so finally, these bark units that it does not come from dogs, it comes from von Bockhausen, who had too long a Germanic name, so they didn't want to, they just called them barks. And here is a graph of these bark units. Sometimes these are also called critical band rates. And sometimes people mean exactly the bark units by that, and sometimes something slightly different. There's also another unit, which is much smaller than barks. They're called mels. And I have 100 times, it's not 100 times, you know, they're vaguely the same shape and stuff, but just get rid of that, because that's a bad enough approximation, better not to have it there. But there are other, you know, there's obviously a variety of ways of measuring psychoacoustic units. This one's nice because it's really, it comes from all sorts of physical things as well as you can arrive at it from human testing and such. So what happens here? This graph has like these weird equations on there. Ignore those. These data points here are the actual data points. And so these are frequency in kilohertz, and these are critical band rates, or barks. Unfortunately, they use Z, which engineers use for delays. So these are not Z to the minus ones. These are, the units are abbreviated Z. And there's generally 24 of them, as you can see there, 0 to 24. Now, I'm going to give you disgusting engineering approximations. What this is, it's a little hard to tell, but this is, you know, kind of a straight line up there. So above 500 hertz, the 0.5 kilohertz here, it's vaguely linear, with note numbers or with octaves. So, you know, a bark is basically a scaled version of note number or a scaled version of octaves, right? When I say note number or octaves, I mean, to me, they're the same. One's multiplied by 12. But so think of them as something proportional to octaves up here or proportional to note numbers. And down here, it's vaguely linear in hertz. So it's something proportional to hertz. And it changes at 500 hertz. Now, that's obviously an approximation to data. If you want better approximations, That's a really rough one, but you know, it's something to think about, and it's a useful approximation. It's like knowing a half step is about 6% in frequency. That about is a pretty big about, but hey, at least it gives you sort of an idea. So here is at the lower here, we've got this thing here, and we've got an equation here. The ZC is 13 arctan of that thing. Somebody came up with and just curve fitted. The arctangent has nothing to do with the original data, with your biology or anything. It's just something that fit that curve. And it does, it fits everything except the very top end. So that's a really common approximation. This one fits the top end, but not the bottom end. So that's a common one. If you want to fit both really well, you do that mess up there. Why would they have this curve fitting? You know, you got this experimental data. Well, psychoacousticians, just like everybody else, wants to integrate and differentiate. Right? If you've got models of the system, it's really nice to be able to do that and to have a closed form formula, even if it's a disgusting thing with arctans in it. It's just useful to have a closed form formula. So those things basically mean nothing to you. They're just on there, but it's sort of interesting to know, oh yeah, you know, it's just data curve fitting. So yeah, so above 500 hertz, another way to say it is linear in cents. Below 100, linear in hertz. All right, the weird approximation function graph are just for convenience. They have no deeper significance but allow mathematical manipulation. Okay, that's what I just said. How are harmonics spaced in the Bark scale? Okay, so this is sort of interesting, right? At least in this higher part, harmonics are equally spaced, right? Harmonics are equally spaced linear hertz. Right? And, or close to equally spaced linear hertz. Well, here, this isn't linear hertz at all, and here it gets closer to linear, but it's this mess. So harmonics are equally spaced, linear and hertz do not equally space along your cochlea. But then, you know, if you're talking about note numbers or cents or octaves, hey, they're sort of linear with Barks in the higher range, so they really have something to do with hearing too. So it's kind of funny, these two things that have conflict all the time. The linear hertz harmonics versus tuning, you know, octaves in musical scales always conflict. They're not the same thing, right? So music basically plays off between the two and tries to find different approaches to making the two play nice with each other. Well, even your ear is sort of in that game. Right, it's fairly linear at low frequencies and then does octaves at higher. Okay, so examples of psychoacoustic and signal processing. 1 dB delta EP. Okay, so first of all, what is the excitation pattern? What the excitation pattern is if you look distance along the cochlea, then excitation pattern shows you what's happening each place along the basilar membrane. I wanted to go back for a second here. One bark, right? It's one critical band, but it's also 1.22 millimeters along the basilar membrane in the cochlea. So it's a distance unit. Although Google is really good at converting units, but I once tried to convert light years to barks, and it didn't work. So it doesn't quite have that. But in any case, it's a weird, you know, it's a distant unit only in the sense that, hey, you know, this really has something to do physically with how your cochlea is built, right? There's some fixed number of hair cells in 1.22 millimeters, and that corresponds to a bark or a critical band. That's about the length at which the interaction gets to be very small between two different things happening along your basilar membrane. Does that make sense? So it is a weird unit. You can convert frequency to bark in Google, but through this method, right, you should be able to do something like convert 440 hertz to meters and. Anyway, what exactly that's supposed to mean, of course, Google can't know. Are you trying to go through barks and meters along basilar membrane? Or are you trying to look at wavelengths? And if it's wavelengths, is it human? And is it underwater? And all these things. So, yeah. So I understand why the Google unit of conversion can't do it. Anyway, so example of psychoacoustics and signal processing, 1 dB audibility test. So what you do here is you have this EP, excitation pattern. That's how much excitation pattern is it along the length of the cochlea. And the distance along the cochlea is usually just measured in parks. You could do millimeters, just multiply by 1.22, it doesn't matter. But usually you see it labeled in barks. So what happens is you try to figure out all along the cochlea how much excitation is there, and if there's only 1 dB difference or less, the rule of thumb is, hey, you can't tell them apart. They sound the same. And this actually works pretty well. It's a bit conservative. Sometimes they sound the same, even if they're a little more than 1 dB. But, you know, if you want to be safe, 1 dB differences. So this is at least something that you can start with where you can do some real signal processing with it. In our case, I had this thing, we were doing additive synthesis at the time. And say that you're playing these two things at the same time. Here's a violin, it's an open A string, me playing, playing a note. You can see it's about, I don't know what, 2 seconds long, a little over 2 seconds long. That's my violin note there. And then at the same time, we also have this trombone. This dude is now dean of engineering, I think, at Purdue. But hey, they had to close too, so we're all the same. But anyway, so but that dean, when he was a student here and working with me, he did this trombone at 277 hertz. So that is his trombone note. It's a muted trombone tone. We recorded it because I could find lots of recordings of trombones, but I didn't find muted ones, so he played some muted ones here. So what's going on here? So this is what the spectrum looks like at time t equals 1 second for both of these. What I was trying to do is try to figure out, if I play both of these at once, I'm doing sine wave synthesis, and I already back then had the theory, which I still have now, but I can't prove. I'll just put it out there. That I think that your hearing system can hear about the same number of partials, no matter how many notes you're playing. So, you know, if you're playing just one note, people say, oh, you only need 40 sine waves to get a pretty good flute. Well, actually, I think you 40 partials, noise partials in our case. Actually, I think you have to be very careful with that. I think you can hear all sorts of detail, but as soon as you play several instruments, there's enough masking and other things going on, you can't hear it. So I thought, okay, I want to take advantage of this. And I'm not the only one that tried to do this with very limited success. But I'll tell you what we did. So we have these two things. So here is just a time t equals 1. I just said, okay, let's just pick a spectrum. Time t equals 1. These are the amplitudes, and these are the amplitudes. What can you see here? One thing is on the vertical axis here. The trombone is much louder than the violin. At least this one, there's 1, 2, 3, fourth partial. Why is the fourth partial so loud while he's playing with a mute? So it's around 1108 hertz. This is in kilohertz here. You can see it's just a little past that. Anyway, that's the fourth partial. And that's super loud. The rest of the trombone is actually pretty quiet. In fact, the second loudest partial, the third one, is quieter than, you know, the loudest four or five of the violin. So you can just sort of, is that right? No, I'm not right. That's not right. Anyway, the violin, the weird thing is when you hear these two next to each other, they sound about the same. But the trombone, actually, its peak is way, way louder. Ignore that other stuff I was saying there. I was confusing myself. You good? All right. So what we want to do is figure out, okay, which sine waves can't we even hear? Then we don't have to synthesize them. So at t equals 1 second, this is the spectrum. Vertical axis is linear, which is standard in, you know, in electronic music. When we look at spectra, we keep the vertical axis standard when we're looking at them. And then horizontal axis kilohertz, we just drew them together. As you can see here, that trombone thingy there is super, super, super tall compared to everybody else. And then as a guess, you know, what do you hear? Clearly, your cochlea, you got the high frequencies, low frequencies at along the cochlea. If you were to say the low frequency part of the cochlea, the high frequency, what would you expect? Well, at the highs, you don't even see anything, so you wouldn't expect much happening there. At the lows, this one big bump. Anyway, it looked kind of promising at this point. Then what do we do? we did a warped or a bark spectrum. All you do is change the x-axis units. Okay, so this is still the same linear amplitude units, but these are barks now in the horizontal. Okay, so that's kind of interesting. All of a sudden, oh well, you know that thing there doesn't represent things very well. Remember, half of that range is just one bark at the high end. You know, one octave, or half of the frequency range, is one bark. Right. So what actually is happening on cochlear looks much more like this. And it's easy to forget that when you're looking at hertz, that, hey, you know, from a quarter sample rate to the half sample rate, that's just one octave or one bark. All right, so if you were just to do a change of units in the horizontal axis, that's what you see. And so there's some weird things like, hey, I was mentioning this before, these aren't even equally spaced anymore. They get closer and closer together as they go higher. It's not the same as if this were in octaves or note numbers or in cents. It's yet a different scale. But it's they get closer and closer together. All right, so this is all approximations, but the idea here is we want uniformity, okay? So what in order to get the best approximation that we could at the time, we just took the vertical axis then. The horizontal axis is now psychoacoustic units of barks. Then we converted the vertical axis to Sohn's units. Now, this is hand-waving because Sohn's units, you know, they're really taken from individual sine waves played by themselves. And here we got a whole bunch of them. We're just saying, hey, let's just use all psychoacoustic units and see how it works. And in fact, people have done this. We didn't invent this with pretty good effect. If you're going to do signal processing on it, there's a way better approximation than if you say, keep it linear amplitude or do linear dB or do vertical axis dB. If you convert to Sohn's, you'll be much happier, especially if you have low and high frequency components. They will play nicer with each other. So all I do is change the vertical axis here it's a decibel unit here, and then you convolve with a parabolic excitation pattern. Kind of reminds you of Smith interpolation. But no, it's sort of that in reverse. But the idea is just, well, you know, it's very vaguely parabolic. Like if you look at along the cochlea, how much it affects the neighbors is vaguely this kind of shape. So you just convolve with that. Just every place where you have a sinusoidal excitation, it spreads out the same. And because you're using psychoacoustic units, that's a rough approximation, but still useful. Where if you were not using psychoacoustic units, it would be total garbage. Like if you go back to the first graph, it looks like, well, half that graph is zero. You know, there's nothing going on there. And that's because, well, we're using linear frequency units. So, okay. So you do this, then you add all this up, right? And you get this excitation pattern. Is this the only way to compute excitation pattern? No, there's actually all sorts of details you can change. Every step here, you can do something slightly different, but it's all the same idea. So you have this excitation pattern. So what is this? This is barks, or critical band rate, along this axis, and that's pretty cool. This is also distance along the cochlea, right? Take these numbers, multiply by 1.2, and it's millimeters along the cochlea. So it's excitation is how much activity is there at each place along the cochlea. And that rule of thumb that I said at the very beginning is the 1 dB audibility test. What you do now is you go through all this stuff, which is much faster when you're a computer program. You do the thing with the partial you're interested in leaving out, you know, if there's one you want to leave out. So do it once with it in, once with it out. And then compare the excitation pattern. If the excitation pattern matches within 1 dB everywhere, then you're safe. You can just leave that one out. Does that make any sense? So that's 1 dB excitation. Now, you could do better audibility tests than that, but because we use psychoacoustic units, just made an effort to do like step one of a reasonable approximation. I'd say this is still a very rough approximation, but it was useful enough. I mean, we actually found it to be quite illuminating. Way better than all the other techniques we've sort of come up with ad hoc to try to see are these two sounds the same or not. One thing, you know, there's lots of stuff to look at here. One of the things, though, about this is it doesn't show anything temporal, right? This is showing the excitation pattern at some time, and it's talking about forward masking, back masking. It doesn't even attempt to do anything about that kind of stuff. We're just looking at excitation patterns here. So one improvement here would be if temporally you could do the excitation, not just in that convolution, if it could be a 3D convolution, so you could also do it temporally, not just for the one spectrum. But there's other things, and it's a problem with the rest of your, or a feature of the rest of your hearing system. We did all this stuff, and it works very nicely. Like if you remove a sine wave that you say by these measures you can't hear, works great. But what happens is during different parts of the tone, during different parts of these two notes playing, you'll have some sine waves that become inaudible. Just because, you know, amplitudes are changing over time. If you look at the original graphs, they're not totally flat amplitudes. So some become inaudible, and then later on become audible again. Well, your ear, if you just leave out that partial and inaudible part, that's no problem. But your ear is really sensitive to things coming in and going out. So we never got anywhere with this because it was too hard to tell. Well, okay, you couldn't hear this partial until we tried to cut out part of it. Then, then you could hear not the doodly-doo effect, but something like that. You know, this thing of your ear is just so sensitive to transitions, much more so than the steady state. In fact, in the steady state, we went as high as 5 dB, and you could get away with it. And well, not always, but 5 dB is a lot. But this problem of when things cut in, cut out, and basically it ended up, it was just way less computation to play all the darn sine waves, even if you had to play thousands of them, than to try to decide can you hear these or not, in real time, if you're playing on a keyboard. So that was our excursion there. Now, when you have compression algorithms and stuff, they don't have to do all this, right? They have the whole recording when they're compressing, or at least a lot of future data. So they don't explicitly go through all of this. The people that came up with those algorithms, of course, know this stuff. But they have a much more basic filter set that they use, which you can look up if you like. It's not really part of this class. Are we good? Yes?
Could you quickly re-explain the 1 dB audibility test?
Okay, so you can make a... if you have some sound, whatever it is. In this case, it was a trumpet and a violin playing at the, or trombone and a violin playing at the same time. Whatever they're doing right at some time, at some instant of time, you can draw a excitation pattern like this for it. You can take any other sound you want. You can draw its excitation pattern. If the two excitation patterns match along everywhere, they won't be exactly the same, but if they're within 1 dB of each other all along the graph at every point, you can be pretty darn sure they're the same. A person will say, oh, these sound the same.
That is useful for?
Just for automatically being able to tell by computer, do these sound the same?
Got it.
And in my case, the application was one which was sort of a misfire, but we were trying to figure out, hey, in additive sine wave synthesis, I believe you can only hear about 160, 170 partials at one time ever. So even if you're playing the biggest symphony there is with a huge choir and everything else, I'm actually convinced it's true. You at any one time, you can only hear 160, 170 partials. If you use those bandwidth-enhanced partial things that we were talking about. But good luck figuring out what they are, and good luck figuring out how to switch between, when some become audible and not audible, like what to do about it. It's just really hard.
Okay, so just to make sure I understand how this would work. So let's just say I took two random instruments, like I took a guitar and a flute, and I just happened to create the excitation patterns, and they were the same everywhere within a decibel somehow.
Yeah.
I don't know how. They would sound exactly the same.
Yes, and more importantly there, what would happen to say, what I was doing, say we're synthesizing it, and you had some really quiet sine waves, where you're saying, no way, you can hear these, just blow them off, don't have to compute those. But it turns out, it's not real easy to check, and it changes over time, and when it changes, it's really hard to sneak a new sine wave in without your ear noticing. So it's just... it didn't pay off for me. I just wanted to show sort of what could you do. So what you can take away from here is if you convert to psychoacoustic units, it is possible to make a reasonable measure of do these two things sound the same. So for instance, if you have some amount of harmonic distortion in a system or something and you can get this graph for before the distortion and after, you can see, well, will you even notice, depending on what kind of music you play. So it's just an automated way to tell. It's a bit conservative, I think. We good? So, when they talk about psychoacoustic signal processing, it can mean different things, but one of the things it often means is, look, just convert your units to psychoacoustic units and then do it. And it turns out that can be a big bang for the buck, even if you're not, you know, if you're sort of doing some hand-waving somewhere along the way, that can still be very useful. Okay, any questions about psychoacoustic stuff? We don't have any psychoacoustic majors here, do we? Last semester we had two. Must have scared them away. All right, well. Yeah, it's always great when you talk about somebody's major. You know, they know way more than you do about it, but that's going to happen in interdisciplinary class. Okay, so for the remainder of the semester, this is a total switch of pace or switch of thing. We're not going to talk about general topics anymore or history. Instead, we're going to talk about different synthesis techniques, approximately one different one per lecture. So they kind of fly by. Again, you know, some of these synthesis techniques are worth many PhDs and much studying, but hey, it's a survey course. So the first thing we're going to do is fixed waveform synthesis, not in the sense that the waveform is ever broken, but in the sense that it exactly repeats. And one thing you know is that if you have a waveform that exactly repeats, it only contains exact harmonics of the fundamental. So fixed waveform synthesis pretty much is talking about electronic-y sounding things, because in the acoustic world, things might be close to ideal. You might have close to ideal strings or close to ideal organ pipes or something, but it's never exactly ideal. You know, strictly speaking, a fixed waveform, so that it really doesn't change when you look at it on a scope, that's really something coming from an electronic instrument. But electronic instruments, especially analog synths, have done great with this. So one of the big things is in analog synthesizers, way back as early as the Tritonium, people were able to make sawtooth waves and then filter them. And that's the big thing that we can do here. Super, super useful. So here is a fixed waveform synthesizer. You got a fixed waveform oscillator, a phase oscillator, or something similar. So you can do phase oscillators, you can do them with a math table function, or you can do what's commonly called a wavetable oscillator, which doesn't use a math function, but really does a table lookup. Both are really useful, but there's other things you can do. Like, say you want a sine wave oscillator. Heck, you can make a narrow band filter. You know that, right? If you have a narrow band enough bandpass filter, it oscillates, you know, if you're careful enough about it, you can get it to make a very nice sine wave for you. So there's all sorts of different ways to do it. But in this case, we're going to talk about phase oscillator approach, because that's what most commonly people do. So what happens here in a typical subtractive synthesis chain? Remember, subtractive synthesis from the first part of this course is when you have lots of harmonics, say a sawtooth, and then you filter out the stuff you don't want. Well, in your fixed waveform oscillator, you got that your phase oscillator, you got that frequency register. So where does that frequency come from? In an analog synthesizer, where this, of course, is not a phase oscillator, but some analog device. You've got a pitch generator, like a keyboard, or maybe a sequencer, a software or hardware sequencer. And then you've got vibrato and portamento generators, other things to make variations in the pitch during notes. And that frequency feeds the fixed waveform oscillator. Then at the end of that, you know, you want to get some interest in amplitude. So you have an envelope generator, which that gets multiplied by, so you have some attack time, some decay time, you know, controls like that to say how your sound evolves. In this kind of setup, it's assuming the standard analog or MIDI synthesizer, where you have a keyboard that starts and stops notes, you got other gadgets that try to add some interest in the note, and then you've got automated amplitude over time. If you look at this like compared to a saxophone or something, well, it's a little different, right? In a saxophone, yes, you know, depending on what your fingering is, you get a different pitch, but you also got to blow just right. You can change how you blow during notes. You can do all sorts of things. You know, how you change pitches and stuff really matters. Like when you do a fall on a saxophone or something, it sounds very different than if you do other sequences of notes. So here, this is a much simplified thing in the sense that this waveform is a fixed waveform, and it only gets started and stopped by the keyboard. The rest of the stuff is automated effects that get put on it. And then you do a filter, and that's that. Okay? So you're getting both aperture variation and timbre variation. The timbre variation comes from the filter. This filter is often going to be a time-varying filter, just because it sounds yet nicer. It doesn't have to be. I've heard very nice examples of like Moog sawtooths or something, just a straight solo. In fact, you still hear it now in pop music pretty often. So it sounds nice enough without filtering sometimes too. All right. So I'm going to play you one example here. We've talked about fixed waveforms, like sawtooths a lot or sine waves, but there's a lot of other ones people use. One of the other ones is a variable duty cycle pulse wave. So down here you have a pulse, okay, and its period is capital T, and delta T, this is unfortunate naming, but this is out of the EC 302 notes. Delta T is it basically has to do with its duty cycle. It's how long is it high. So you can change the duty cycle of the pulse wave. Okay, and that's a common analog thing to do. I'm going to play you an example here from Mark Smart, who works down in the electronic services shop. You should visit him sometime. He does a nice job on many things. He's a good musician. He sometimes plays around town, plays a bunch of different instruments, including continuum. This example is going to be a continuum example. He also plays sax. He does lots of stuff. So he's an interesting guy to know. He's made all sorts of pedal boards, all sorts of guitar processing, and lots of stuff. That is, if you're interested in, definitely somebody to know when you're here. Okay, so in this case here, I'm going to play his example. This is something he first implemented, I think, by hacking up an ARP AX, and then he did this digitally. So this is done in Reactor. What does he have? Well, he's got the continuum X position for pitch. It makes it a little easier to make it sound interesting because you can control the vibrato of every note. You know, then the vibrato isn't the same on every note like it would be if it were automated. So he's got the continuum X position there. He uses the Y position, which, as you know, is much less accurate than X position. But he uses it to good effect. What he does is the Y position controls a 75 hertz sine wave thing added into the pitch, bless you, which is a weird thing to do, but it makes a sound that sounds kind of like a growl on a sax. I don't know how he discovered this. It's pretty cool, though. So in this example, you'll hear it sometimes. When he kind of gets that growl in there, it just moves. He's moving Y on his continuum and adding some growl there just by 75 hertz. See, 75 hertz is way above a normal vibrato rate. A normal vibrato rate is couple of hertz, or maybe sometimes even a fraction of a hertz, but it's not 75 hertz. That's sort of in the audio range. In any case, you get this growl effect. And then he's got a pulse, 80% duty cycle pulse wave. Now, you can make such a thing by making modifications to phase oscillator. I'll talk about the problems with it, but in any case, it's a 80% duty cycle. You get the same timbre if you make a 20% duty cycle. That's sort of up to you. Then he's got these filters, so it's almost like it's a model of the instrument in a very, very simplistic way. I don't know if you wouldn't normally call this physical modeling, but it sort of is. I mean, you're modeling parts of the instrument. So he's got a brightness control. It's just a two-pole low-pass filter, and the pressure controls that. So it changes in brightness. It gets mellower as you play quieter. Then he's got another one, which is like when you want to have an effect of different mouthpieces. He's got a mouthpiece filter there. It's another two-pole bandpass filter. And he just sort of sets this up ahead of time. You know, he has some favorite mouthpiece-like thing. Does that give you every detail of every? No, of course not. Come on, it's a two-pole filter. But it's reminiscent of a mouthpiece thing. And then he's got a body filter, which is a weird filter. It has a different low and high. It has two different things. In fact, in the Egan matrix, you'd have to use two separate filters and add out add the output to do this. But he's got a body filter, which is sort of a fixed filter, has slower cutoff down than lower than high, and then at the end he has just a straight out amplitude multiplied by everything that's the pressure. So I'm going to play you this example. This example, it depends what you want out of electronic music. When I listened to it at first, I thought, wow, you know, this is really like too antiseptic for me. There's no like air noise. He likes this percussion that's like the soft jazz percussion, but it's like exactly the same. Every hit is exact, but he likes that. That cleanness of it is actually, you know, artistically something you like. It's kind of like all the kitschy sounds you hear nowadays that are used to good effect in pop music, right? I mean, there's all sorts of historic sounds people use and sample that are, you know, originally it's like, that's supposed to be a what? You know, and anyway, they make for good music. So listen to this, not, oh, are you fooled that it's real sax or not, but just for its own beauty. And actually also for that beauty of, or that interesting aspect of it, that it doesn't have the air rushing, it doesn't have all the other noises that you would have out of sax, but it's still a quite beautiful thing. So I'm going to play you this Mark Smart sound. And if you're tired, just imagine being in a smoky bar. Actually, they're not smoky anymore, are they? But whatever. Maybe they're smoky, but not. Anyway, never. I won't go there. Growl if you heard that there. Effect there, right? Here, I'll do it again, just the last few notes there, just before I stopped. It has that growl roughness to it. What's cool about that is, I mean, he's a good player, but beyond that, you know, this is a pretty simple thing, right? It's just a pulse wave and a couple of low-pass filters. None of these are 310 challenge. They're two-pole filters. You know, you just use a standard one. It's all very straightforward stuff, but it is quite beautiful for something quite simple. Any questions about that? So I just want to say quickly here, pulse waves are really easy in analog, right? Got no half sample rate. So in analog, you've got this nice square cornered wave, and it gets you an effect like this, where if you change the duty cycle, you can see you change the main lobe width here, so you can get more or fewer of the low partials really strong. In this case, it's wiping out the third partial just by, you know, because that's what the example is. But you can move that around and thereby get a brighter sound or a less bright sound, depending on how you change the duty cycle. So it's very nice. You can have this thing going. So independent of changing frequency, which is capital T, you can also change main lobe width, which is delta T. So you can change a brighter and less bright. So that's a very useful thing. In this case, he's controlling from the continuum, so he's sort of cheating. If you did that from an envelope generator, it would be hard to make it sound as nice as somebody's fingers. But yeah, so that's that. Now, the problem is when you do this digitally, well, you got the half sample rate. So you can't have a window, a square thing like that, right? You can't have square pulses. If you did that in digital, you're not getting what you think you are. Digital only has frequencies up to half sample rate. So basically what you would be getting is what you think you are plus a whole bunch of extra gunk. It's just aliased n times over. What you got to do, just like in 3.10 you learned you have to use window functions, well, you got the same thing here. If you use a raised cosine for your pulse, or something similar, there's other options there, but you very much reduce the alias thing. And yeah, so you get something much more like this. So instead of doing the square thing, you do a raised cosine. But you can use a phase oscillator kind of structure, right? Because you just have a certain amount of dead time in between your pulses. So it's a little different than a phase oscillator. You got to figure out, well, how would I set this up? Like, say you did this as 385 project, you'd have to figure out, okay, how do you make a variable duty cycle? You'd have to mess with your code some, but it's a very similar idea. It's just you don't go on to the next period. You got this wait time in between periods. Are we good? One easy way to do it if you're doing it digitally is just to have a whole bunch of wavetables that are different duty cycle. Pick the duty cycle one you want. And if you're changing duty cycles and you don't want to jump, just do a crossfade. You know, there's lots and lots of ways to solve it. Really no harder than doing a sawtooth. All right, are we good? Okay, so next time I will talk more about different stuff about how to do fixed waveforms. Do watch for it on Echo 360. Echo 360, as far as I can tell, does no live streaming. If you know otherwise, let me know. So what I will do here is I will come and talk to an empty classroom, and you guys can see it, but not until class is over. So I think pretty much punctually at 9:30, you'll be forced to sleep in a little more, unfortunately. But at 9:30, you can see it, or any time later. Please don't let them all pile up till the week of finals. Don't do that to yourself. If you have questions for me during during the presentation, please note the time to stop your Echo 360, note the time on it, send me an email with your question, because I don't get that many questions in here, but I do get, you know, three or four each time, and they're really important. Speaking of. It won't. In some ways, you know, there's at least one bright spot about the virus. I don't know how labs will work. I'm tempted to say they won't, but I've heard conflicting things. I've heard that, oh yeah, people can still go to lab, but then I've also heard that, oh, well, you can stay home and you don't have to come back to campus at all. So I don't see how those two fit. We'll see. In any case, thank you very much. Yeah, I will email the handouts and the audio examples. And then you got to wait for the Echo 360.
I don't know whether you're willing to or will be able to make this work.